Brothers and sisters, we continue with the narration of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, which is reported by al-Bukhari and Muslim, may Allah have mercy on them, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave a similitude to good company and bad company. Good company being the owner of musk and bad company being a blacksmith. Each influence and affects their company accordingly, one in a good way and one in an evil way. There is no doubt that one of the greatest blessings and bounties of Allah Azza wa Jalla upon a person, that He grants him an environment, a company, friends who are like him, who are at the same or a higher level than his with regards to faith and manners. And this is one favor which the slave needs to be extremely grateful to Allah for. Therefore, one who has it should hold on strong to it, and the one who doesn't should look for it day and night. And this is more confirmed with regards to two types of people: newcomers to Islam, new Muslims, or those who were deviant and Allah Azza wa Jal blessed them to go back to the path. Those who are off track and Allah Azza wa Jal put them on track. These are the ones who need to replace the blacksmith to an owner of musk. These are the ones who need to shun the old company and friends and look for a replacement. And I'm not saying look for an improvement within. No, the entire set, the entire package needs to be changed. Because if one allows himself to continue with the same group, he's subjecting himself to the danger of slipping. He needs to be looking for good company who will help him remain steadfast and strengthen his faith. As in the famous narration that is reported by Muslim and narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in this narration that a man killed 99 souls in his locality. This man didn't leave a house without killing someone in it. And then he suddenly felt an urge, a strong, sincere urge to repent to Allah. So people guided him to a monk, a worshiper. He went to him and he told him the story. He said, "Is there a way for me to repent?" He said, "How can you repent after killing 99 souls? So he killed him and made 100. And went on in his life. But then again, that same sincere urge came back to him. The man was sincere. He wanted to repent. He wanted to give up. So people guided him to a scholar who was a wise scholar. He said, "The gate of repentance will never be closed. Allah has it open until you die." He said, "So what should I do?" He said, "Go to such and such land. It has good, pious people in it who worship Allah, so worship Allah with them. Number one. And never come back to your land because it's a land of evil. Number two." So the first one is to go and replace the blacksmith to a musk owner. And number two is never to go back to the blacksmith or anything reminding you with the evil. And this is the point. You need to shun this old company and friends because they usually are reminders to you. You start remembering incidents, conversations, things that happened that were evil, and shaitan starts beautifying this to you again to make you slip. So it's very important that one stays away, replaces the group, replaces the company, and looks for a good company and puts himself into that new environment who can help him remain steadfast and elevate the level of faith. Now, once he becomes strong in faith enough, he can always go back and establish communication with his old deviant friends, one by one, with the intention of trying to bring in them to the right path with which he was blessed. But if he discovers, as he starts, that he wasn't strong enough, or they're more dominating in their personalities and character, then he needs to immediately withdraw and keep himself safe, because we are responsible for ourselves before others. And the only judge in this matter is oneself. Therefore, the issue of company is not a casual matter. And especially when we start talking about it in relation to cultivation and upbringing of children and youth, it's a very dangerous matter indeed. So a wise parent should not deal with the issue of his or hers children's friends and company as a matter that has no impact or influence on them, as a casual, spontaneous matter. No! No, it is the most dangerous thing that a parent encounters when upbringing his child. Studies say that children, or youngsters in general, are recipient, are influenced by the following sources: parents, father, mother, older brothers and sisters, relatives, teachers at school, and peer, classmates, friends, companions. And I add to this non-Muslim study, the imam in the masjid, or any spiritual source for that youngster. However, the study says that the company of the child, his peers alone, influence him with 60% of the formation of his character and personality, while all the others collectively form only about 40%. It is the most challenging aspect of upbringing the child. So a wise parent should be open his eyes, and should be heedful all the time of who is my son or daughter have as company and friends. Because it's proven that most deviations in youngsters start from the influence of their friends and company. Friends of our children can either take them to destruction or help them to piety. Take an example. How do youngsters start smoking? They see someone in their company, some of the group, smoking, and the other one starts inviting, take a cigarette. It's manly, right? And start encouraging and encouraging, and they don't give up. Shaitan doesn't give up. Until that boy, or girl for that matter, slips into the first cigarette, and then the rest is easy. And from cigarettes, that leads to drugs. I know families personally whose parents, the youth's parents, are practicing committed couples who were all the time in the masjid. Their children did not only get on drugs, but became drug dealers. At the age of 15, And they were caught and taken into juvenile detention. And where did this come from? It had to start somewhere. He didn't suddenly jump into becoming a drug dealer. Take another phenomenon. The issue of driving like maniacs on the street. You see youth tailgating you. When you look in the mirror, you fear that he's at the back of your seat, not behind you in the car. Zigzagging on the highway, going wrong way, passing, running red lights, squealing the wheels. Some people, I don't know how, but they get on two wheels and drive. All of this crazy, insane practice was picked up from somebody else who either encouraged them or they imitate. Just last week or 10 days ago, I received a message that three young men, 15, 15, and 16, all died in one accident, one car wreck. The percentage of death and casualties resulting from car accidents is rising year after year, everywhere. And this is prohibited. Allah tells us, لا تقتلوا أنفسكم. Don't kill yourselves. And this is a form of killing ourselves. This youth is killing himself in this manner. Ibn al-Qayyim, rahmatullahi alayhi, divided friends or companions into three different categories. Brothers, again, we have brothers opening the door and standing at the door. Please, we'll squeeze as much as we can. It doesn't have to be a prayer row. And at the time of the salah, we'll squeeze back. Please, jazakumullahu khair. Come forward, brothers, come forward. Ibn al-Qayyim, rahmatullahi alayhi, may Allah have mercy on him, divided friends and company into three different categories. Number one, he said the first one is like a nutrition that is always needed. Number two is like a remedy, like a treatment, which one needs at times, but not all the time. And number three is a disease, which one never needs. As for the first one, it's the good company. So one must stay with. He is in need of such company all the time. And the last is also easy. It's the evil company that can kill you, destroy you, a fatal disease. Now the challenging one is the second one, which mixes good and bad. Has goodness and has evil in them. And what help us judge this and know how to deal with this is a very great fundamental of faith. Which is the fundamental of love and hate for the sake of Allah. Loyalty and enmity for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this is narrated by Ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, and reported by At-Tabarani, classified as authentic by Al-Albani. He said, the greatest fundamental of faith is loyalty for Allah and enmity for Allah, loving for Allah and hating for Allah the Almighty. So with regards to the second class or category, it's proportional. The first one is obvious. You keep company of these. You stay with these. You befriend these. And the last company, you stay away from them, you shun them, you don't associate yourself with them. The second one is judgmental. You see how much good and how much evil is there in them?
and you try to benefit from the goodness in them. However, if one sees that he is not strong enough to differentiate or not to be influenced by the evil they have, then he needs to stay away. Now, this or in this lies a serious problem. Some people have a serious problem of not possessing the tool or the sense to judge when to stop and when to go on. You see some people having no issue. They mix with any gathering. You put them in any group, in the company of whatever people, he's fine. He'll be sitting in a gathering where people are exchanging obscene words. Some people might be smoking, music will be playing, sometimes girls will be there, whatever, right? And he has no issue. He's sitting there having fun, laughing. He goes then and goes to sit in the masjid in a study circle, and he's also learning. Now, that's dangerous on this person. So we need to be the judge. Again, the judgment in this is in our hands. We need to apply the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and see how much of it we can apply. If we can't, then it is safer for us and for those under our guardianship, because they will see whom we befriend as well. And Allah addressed us saying, Ya ayyuhal ladina amanu, qu anfusakum wa ahlikum naran wa qudha an-nas wal hijara. O you who have believed, protect yourselves and your families, the fire whose fuel is humans and stones. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to protect us from the fire of hell, and to guide us and our children to the best company and friends. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala sayyidil khalqi ajma'in, Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Thumma amma ba'd. Alqama al-Ataridi, may Allah have mercy on him, advised a man once and said, stay in the company of those whom when you sit with would adorn you with their manners, with their piety. It wears out on you, it reflects on you, so you will be adorned with piety and manners. Stay in the company of those whom when you sit with, they would adorn you. And when you extend the hand for virtue, they will extend the helping hand. And whom when you err, they forget. And when you do something good, they mention it. This is the type of company we need to be looking for. We need to be picking our friends. As Ali radiallahu anhu said, he said, when you're about to befriend someone, when you want to make yourself a companion of someone, then test them, check them out. Then he said, it is not for the sake of exposing their faults, but rather to discover their reality and then decide for yourself whether or not you want to be in the company of such people or person. Al-Khattab ibn al-Mu'alla al-Makhzumi advised his son one day, saying, O son, stay away from evil company, as they have the tendency to corrupt those who sit with them. If you want to perfect your faith and manners, then stay away from evil company. And remember that a person is identified and classified according to the company he puts himself in. And the words of Abu Hatim, rahmatullahi alayhi, regarding this issue, he said, it is mandatory upon every sane Muslim to seek refuge in Allah Azza wa Jal from being in the company of those whom when he tries to remember Allah, they don't assist him. When he forgets, they don't remind him. And when he gets heedless, they encourage him. And the one who insists to be in the company of evil people is the worst of them. Then he says, good company grants you goodness, and evil company grants you evil, just like wind. When it blows over something pleasant, it spreads a pleasant fragrance. And when it passes over something rotten, it reflects something detestable. And we must know, brothers and sisters, that the company we choose will have an impact on us in this life and the hereafter. And to give an example of how evil companions and friends influence the person in this life, I will mention the story of Abu Talib. That is in the book of Al-Bukhari and the book of Muslim. Al-Musayyab ibn Hazm, may Allah be pleased with him, said, when Abu Talib was in his death illness, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of love and gratitude to him, raising him up and taking care of him and protecting him in his mission, he went to continue his effort of trying to guide his uncle. So he went in and he saw Abu Jahl and Abdullah ibn Umayyah sitting with him. So he said, oh uncle, say la ilaha illallah, a word which I can use to testify for you with Allah. So these two evil men immediately jumped in and said, oh Abu Talib, are you going to give up the faith of your father Abdul Muttalib? Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam repeated his invitation to him again, and these two evil men continued to argue with him the same until Abu Talib said the last words and passed away. He said, no, I will die on the faith of Abdul Muttalib. Look how this evil company destroyed the man's hereafter. That's why Ibn Hajar said, commenting on this narration, he said, this narration is a clear prohibition for one to be in the company of those who can harm him with regards to his worldly matters or matters related to the hereafter. And it encourages people to be in the company of those who will benefit them in matters related to this dunya, this life, or the hereafter. But it doesn't stop in this world. It goes beyond that. It goes to the akhirah. Allah Azza wa Jal says, الْأَخِلَّاءُ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌّ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ. Close friends on that day will be enemies of one another, except the pious. But on the other hand, if you're in the company of good people, you can benefit a lot. Al-Hasan al-Basri rahmatullah alayhi said, make sure you make as many pious friends as you possibly can, because they will benefit you on the hereafter. How is that? Well, there is a narration in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us that the people of Jannah on the day of judgment, after they've taken their places, they would look around and talk to one another and say, we had companions and friends with us in dunya, which in this life, which we don't see in paradise. So they would go and intercede for them with Allah. They would say, oh Allah, we had brothers, we had friends who used to fast with us, pray with us, perform jihad with us, but we don't see them with us in Jannah. We don't see them around in paradise, and our joy will not be perfected unless they are with us. So Allah Azza wa Jal will tell them, go, and whomever of them you can recognize in the fire of hell, take them out. And they would go to the fire, and they would recognize them because the fire did not burn their faces, and they would recognize them, but some will be burning up unto here and up to the knees and down to the heels, different levels. And when they will take them all out and take them by hand into Jannah. The choice is ours, for us and for our children. We make that call. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to enable us make the right choice and facilitate pious, well-mannered company for us, for our wives, for our children, and for our loved ones. Allahumma amin. Allahumma aslihna wa aslih dhurriyatina. Allahumma aslihna wa aslih dhurriyatina. Allahumma aslihna wa aslih dhurriyatina.